Hello and welcome to banddirector.com. My name is Dave Knox and I'm here with Robert Boudreau with the American Wind Symphony Orchestra.
Correct.
And we're here in the Pilot House on beautiful Lake Michigan in Mackinac City, Michigan. And we're going to talk a little bit about the orchestra and its history and its future and some interesting things. If you've never heard about the orchestra, you can find more information on their website, and then hopefully through this interview interest you into finding a next concert date, location, and come down and see the orchestra perform. I was very surprised because I had never heard about it, being years in the music industry, this unique and wonderful, how would you describe?
Well, I guess you'd describe it like Haida Villa-Lobos did. I met Haida Villa-Lobos back in 56 at the Essex House in New York. And I came to commission him because there was literally no music for wind orchestra. And so I had gone to C.F. Peters to see Walter Heinrichsen, who was then the publisher of the New York operation of C.F. Peters. And he agreed to publish all the music that I would commission. So I went to Villa-Lobos and he said, he spoke terrible French and Portuguese. And I had been a Fulbright scholar at the Paris Conservatory. And so by that time I was speaking pretty bad French also. But when you speak a language poorly, two people speak a language poorly, you understand each other very
perfectly.
Well, because you do it slowly, etc. His comment was, I know write for band. I write for the winds, the brass, and the percussion of the symphony orchestra. Now, I have to go back a little bit for that, because I had gone to Boston University and actually majored in English Lit, and I was playing with Robert King of Music for Brass. I don't know if you remember that. It's a big publication. And Bob King, you played euphonium, and I was a member of the Boston Brass Quartet. And we did many churches and all kinds of things. Well, it was a great deal of music from the Renaissance and the Baroque, and a lot of antiphonal music, Gabrielli. So when I first started the Wind Symphony, my thought was that I'd have two wind orchestras, so I'd have an antiphonal wind orchestra. So in the beginning, I actually had six bassoons and six oboes, and etc., so I could divide them and have three oboes and three flutes and three bassoons, etc. So I could have antiphonal music. That was the beginning of it, the beginning idea of it, because I had been so much involved with King, and he was a tremendous musician. Yeah. He was also a professor at Harvard. So when I met Villa-Lobos, he in turn said, wind of the orchestra. Now, going back a little further than that, when I went to Juilliard in 1947, I met with Richard Franco Goldman, who actually was one of my mentors. Richard hated conducting. So anything where there was conducting, whether at Princeton or wherever, and because he knew I was associated with Bob King, he said, you conduct. Well, I really hadn't done much conducting at that time, but I'd go out to Princeton with him on the train. He'd go somewhere, I don't know where, and I'd conduct the band. And then for several years I played with the Edwin Franco Goldman Band in Central Park. I don't know if you knew that or not. And also played at the Metropolitan Opera. So I was involved with bands at that point, as well as orchestras with the Met. It was a different kind of music. With Dr. Goldman, everything was more or less transcriptions, as we know how the old bands existed. I don't think I wanted to do that. I didn't want to replicate another Sousa or Goldman band. But when Villa-Lobos put this concept in my mind, all of a sudden I realized that this is probably the way I should go. Fennell was one of my big supporters. I mean, there are many that were not my supporters. They thought I was trying to destroy the band. Ravelli said to me one day, he approached me in a very angry manner and said, "You're trying to destroy the bands." And I said, "I'm not. I'm just creating another wind, a vehicle for wind, brass, and percussion instruments." But Fennell was not that way. In fact, the first wind orchestra I had back in 1957, half of the people were from Easton, because he was so supportive of this idea. And he performed much of the music that I had commissioned. And people say, "Well, you're against saxophone." Well, that's not so, because I had Sigurd Rascher. I don't know if you remember that name. A great saxophone player, one of the greatest in the world, would come and play, for instance, the Henry Brandt. There's a wonderful concerto for a saxophone, but it's mainly winds. It's still the wind instruments that are not saxophones or euphoniums or whatever. It's the wind orchestra primarily, small wind orchestra with saxophone. So the reason I don't use saxophones or euphoniums, because you don't use them in a symphony orchestra. I only use the instruments that are basically, you could take my wind symphony and put it with some strings and you'd have a symphony orchestra. So that's basically it. And today, my instrumentation is primarily fours. Four flutes, four oboes, four clarinets, four bassoons, and then fives and sixes in the brass, one tuba, and harp, very important, and keyboard, very, very important. Those are very important instruments to us. And six percussion. And the heart of the wind orchestra is my percussion section. They're right in front on the apron of the stage, as you'll see tonight. Mm. They're not in the back at all. They're the pulse of my whole commissioning program, basically. You'll see a piece that we do tonight called Three Fragments by Yaruda Wada, a really wonderful Japanese composer, where we use odaiko drums and taiko drums, and which he's incorporated Japanese temple bells, whatever. So you'll see that percussion section is really vibrant in the front. It covers the whole front of the stage. It's 75 feet. And from one side to the other is percussion. There'll be two marimbas out there, two vibraphones, eight timpani, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's two sets of chimes. I normally sometimes use three sets of chimes. We're doing a piece by Andrei Petrov tonight called Russian Capriccio, which we commissioned when we went to Russia with the boat. Oh, by the way, we were the first U.S. flag vessel to go to Russia since the time of Lenin, since 1917. And it was during the time of Gorbachev. Anyway, I was fortunate enough to meet with Andrei Petrov, who was then the president of the United Soviet Composers Union. Yeah. And he'd written three or four really wonderful works. There's a wonderful trumpet concerto he did for me. Five Russian folk songs he did for me. He did this piece, the Russian Capriccio, which was the first piece that he wrote for me. So we do that piece tonight, and we do we open up with a piece that we commissioned when we went to Ireland with the boat. We went to Cork Island, a fellow by the name Patrick Zook. But we have now over 450 works. It's the largest commissioning program ever, even more than Prince Esterhazy.
And all these pieces are available through
Peters,
C.F. Peters.
They're all available through Peters.
So this idea that when you were talking about being back at Eastman, this idea of...
No, I was at Julia.
Julia, your own style, that started the commission process.
Well, it started with Villa-Lobos, basically, because I started... my first group was called the American Wind Ensemble, although I didn't use saxes then. Mm-hmm. It was called the Wind Ensemble, because a wind ensemble can be anything. Mm-hmm. Right? Can be three trumpets and two clarinets and a tuba. That's a wind ensemble. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have to be a full group. Fennell had what was a wind ensemble, what later became known as, it had saxophones in it, but only one on a part. Mm-hmm. And that's the difference between the wind ensemble and the wind orchestra, basically. We only carry wind on a part. We don't double anything. Mm-hmm. Except sometimes we're doing chorale things where we want a bigger sound. But basically it's one on one part. Okay. And what has happened actually in the Wind Symphony actually originated in 1957. That's when the first terminology. Now you see Wind Symphonies all over the place, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You see the name. Because I somehow think that there's some magic, but they come out bands. I mean, they still have saxophones and euphoniums, but they call themselves wind symphony. It's not a wind symphony. It's still either a wind ensemble or wind band. No, it's not. A wind symphony orchestra is one that only has the winds, the brass, and the percussion that are associated with the symphony orchestra. That's what a wind orchestra is. Now, Lenny Bernstein, we commissioned a fellow named David Amram, I don't know if you know that name, French horn, he used to be French horn player with the Washington, National Symphony in Washington. David did a wonderful concerto for horn, and Chambers, who was the horn, one of the horn soloists at the England Philharmonic, did that work. He rearranged it several times, but Bernstein did the original, just like what I do in terms, he just used the winds, the brass, and percussion. And David Amram was the first composer in residence with the New York Philharmonic under Lenny Bernstein. So there's a lot of ties here.
The players of the orchestra, do they travel on the boat here?
No, they travel by van.
They travel by van.
So they go into a community before we ever get there and start chamber music, educational programs.
Okay.
So we involve ourselves very much in terms of the community.
And that's unique in itself.
Well, we're there in a community normally 4 or 5 days.
Okay.
So we're here for 4 days. And then we run now to Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, Canada.
And do you travel with the boat though? Or are you traveling by van as well?
I have, to answer the question quickly, my wife and I decided early on when the boat came to be that we wanted to have it as a family thing. So my wife has a 1,000-ton license as a first mate.
Is that right?
And I have a 1,000-ton license as a master, so I have a Coast Guard license. So that when I finish a concert, I come up here on the pilot house and take it to the next place.
Is that right? Yeah. So you are the captain?
I am the captain also.
I'm looking out over the lake here, Lake Michigan. It can get rough sometimes.
Oh, it was rough coming. We came from Manistee, and we had 5 and 6 foot waves, but rough is not the word, because when we went down around Cuba, we had a Caribbean tour, and we went to Guantanamo Bay years ago when it was a wonderful, like New England down, not all this junk that's going on today. And we would come to, the waves were a little short, so we'd come to the end of the waves and we would dive, literally, come to the end of a wave, and it's like coming to the end of the world, and the boat would literally dive and shake, just shake, you know, and it's very well built, it's an ocean going vessel, it's double hull, but we just shake and then it sort of stop, and then it start again, until the next wave we hit, and then we go boom. There were Russian ships coming around to go into Havana, Cuba at that time, and they were going like 1 and 2 knots, I mean, and they're big ships, they're not like little meat, and it was that rough out there. We came out of, on our way back home from Europe, we were there for 3 years. We came back home through Fort Myers and we're heading north up into Panama City. And we got a weather report that was 2 feet northerner coming down. We got 2 foot waves. So I had a life boat out in front, life raft out in front. Mm-hmm. And it deflates when there's 15 feet of water over it. And I noticed it was about midnight we were traveling, with this little red light coming on. And I said, oh, that's nice, the Coast Guard's coming to help us. It was my life raft it had, you know. There it was, sitting right out there. So we were under 15, 20 feet of water sometimes.
Wow.
So.
And this is, you know, I was surprised coming on the boat for the first time and just approaching it on the drive up. It's a large vessel.
It, 195 feet long.
It was a lot larger than I expected, yeah. You know, just reading about it from the website. Yeah. So as far as the future goes, I mean, after tonight, you're going to be making your way around
Michigan. The boats go, yeah, we go, we'll finally get into the Illinois River, and then hang a left when we get down to Grafton, Illinois, which is where the Mississippi, where we begin with the Mississippi. Mm-hmm. Mississippi goes north to Minneapolis. We're going to go south, and we finish in Cape Girardeau just about a month from today, and then the boat will go down to Louisiana. And what I give you a quick background. When we were in Kingston, Jamaica, I got a call from the Ministry of Culture from Havana, Cuba. And they invited my wife and myself to go because we had been very much involved with a number of things in South America. And so we went to Havana. We couldn't fly in from the States, but we could fly in from there. And they never stamped your passport, so nobody knew whether we came or went or whatever. They don't do that in Havana. They don't. And so we've started a very long and wonderful relationship with what they call the Cuban Interest Section in Washington, which is really the Cuban Embassy, but we don't acknowledge that it's a Cuban embassy for whatever reason, political and commercial and whatever. And so I go and visit them once or twice a year to the Cuban intersection, which is located in the Swedish embassy. And there's an ambassador there, but we don't call him an ambassador. So anyway, we have a relationship with them, and we're working very hard now to take the boat to Havana, Cuba during the month of May 2010 and have a what we call opening the doors to the Americas. And we have, as you'll see when we go through the boat, there are paintings from Haiti, from Canada, from Venezuela, from Mexico, from all over. And the idea is to bring not only the arts people, music, painters, theater, but also corporate people and business people all together for a nice confab where we can talk about what the future of, as Americans and as the people of the Americas, because we are one people, basically. We extend from Argentina to Canada. And we may be different in many ways, but we have one goal in common, and that's to help each other. And we must do that more and more. We've ignored our neighbors too long in so many cultural and economic ways, and that has to change. And that's what that our boat's going down there to do. And we'll be playing music from composers that I've... Well, let me go back a little bit. And when I met with Villa-Lobos, I was young, and I was filled with vim and vigor, which I still hopefully am. But I said, how can I save the world? You know, we all come to that point, like you. How can we save the world? He said, go to Mexico and commission composers. And he got on the phone and called a man by the name of Jose Garcia Barras, who was in the linen industry, a very wealthy man. His daughter studied with Serkin, Rudolf Serkin, the great pianist. And his son studied cello with Pietrogorsky. I mean, he couldn't get more high-rated teachers than those people. He also started the first Pablo Casals Festival in Veracruz. So he had all kinds of contacts with all kinds. So for a week or so, I went, 3 days later, I was on an Eastern Airline flight heading for Mexico City and met with these young, relatively young and older composers. I guess we must have, for instance, there's a Blas Galindo, who was a very close friend of Carlos Chavez, who's like sort of the father of Mexican music, as we know. And Blas did a number of works for us. And so Enrique Santos did a wonderful concerto for guitar and harpsichord with limbs for us. So we started, I started beginning to become very, very much involved. And you'll see when you go downstairs, I also commissioned seven women artists to do particular works for me, paintings, etc. So this boat is not just music, but it's also the visual arts. So when people will come on board, they'll see paintings, really wonderful paintings, many in the 10 number figures down there. For instance, there's a man by the name of Salazar, who was commissioned to do the official portrait of the last pope. His piece is down. So that's the whole idea. The boat becomes the Americas, opening the doors to the Americas. And we want everybody that has an interest, not just in Cuba, but in terms of how do we begin to communicate more with the people from Chile. For instance, Juan Rodrigo Salas, who was a composer at Indiana University in Bloomington for years, he's now 92 years old, did two or three works for me. So we have composers from Ginastera. We have a wonderful piece by Ginastera, by Juan Rodrigo Salas. So, and Leo Brava, who was a famous guitarist from Cuba, who was the conductor of the Havana Symphony Orchestra, wrote a piece for me as well. I tell you why. It must be 20 years ago. I decided I wanted to have some of my musicians come in from the Americas. So I went to Nicaragua, Panama, Haiti, Jamaica, Colombia. And when I was in Colombia, I met with Luis Perez, who was a hornist with the Bogota Symphony Orchestra. And I said, you're a wonderful performer. It was a remarkable horn player. Played just beautiful, never made a mistake. Just and played like a chamber music player. And I said, who do you study with? He said, I study with a drunken clarinet player. Okay. So I began to think, well, hey, maybe I can help these young people, because he was relatively young, even though he was playing professionally. So I invited 12 of them from Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Colombia, etc., to come to Pittsburgh. And I had what was called a Stephen Foster House there. where Steenforth, he wasn't born there, but he was born on that property. I went to the presidents of Carnegie, Duquesne, and University of Pitt. I said, if you educate them, I will feed them and clothe them. Mm. And all of them got degrees.
Is that right?
All 12. And there's one who's now playing English horn with the Metropolitan Opera. They're playing all over the place in the state. But a number went back to Costa Rica and back to their homes as well. So anyway, Leo Brower heard about this. Now, he's the conductor of the Van Cubas Orchestra, and a very famous guitarist. And one day in the mail, I receive a score. And it's called Canción de Gesta. And it's subtitled Boat Loaded with Future. That was his gift to me.
Is that right?
For doing that. It's one of the most remarkable, wonderful pieces. A lot of conga drums. It's a lot of Cuba and also Africa. Yeah, African kind of music.
Yeah.
So we have a really remarkable relationship now with that part of the world. Now this boat itself was designed by the famous Louis Kahn, K-A-H-N.
Mm-hmm.
You know that name?
It had a few buildings in Detroit, Michigan.
No, that's a different car.
That's a different car.
That's
okay.
A different car. Louis Kahn did the capital city in Bangladesh. Mm. He also did the Jonas Salk complex. Remember Jonas Salk? He was a polio guy.
Yes.
Out on the coast. He did the medical buildings at the University of Philadelphia. University of Pennsylvania. So that's my life, pretty much. I grew up as a poultry farmer in Massachusetts. We had about 10,000 breeder hens. I wanted to be a chicken farmer. My father had a third grade education and decided that wasn't the way I should go. And he put me in the mill for one of the textile mills for about 4 weeks during the summer. And he told the guys, give him the most boring job he can, which they did. And after about 4 or 5 weeks, I said, Dad, I think maybe it's a good idea to go to college. So I went to Boston University and majored in English Lit. But I was playing with the Rhode Island Philharmonic, and I started playing with the Rhode Island Philharmonic when I was 15 or so, and doing a lot of polka bands. Had a lot of polka bands up there. And played with the Boston Brass Quartet. And so when I was 18, I graduated from, because it was during the war, you could have accelerated program. When I was 18, I graduated, went on to Juilliard. Got a couple more degrees there. And that's how it all began. And of course, playing at the Met and the Goldman Band gave me another professional background. And here we are now, 450 works later. And all the works that you're going to hear tonight, except for a couple, which are kickers, like we do the dirge from New Orleans, and up a lazy river kind of thing, big band kind of thing, which have been orchestrated for me, basically. Everything will be wind orchestra. So you'll hear Handel's Music for the Royal Fireworks, which was one of the first done for wind orchestra, basically, because he just used oboes. I think he used 24 oboes, 12 bassoons, a couple serpents, trumpets, French horn, timpani, but that was it. And then he wrote that in 1719, and 2 years later he reorchestrated the strings, but the strings just doubled the oboes, etc. So you're basically going to hear how Handel wrote just for me. You know, it was nice. I thought George was very nice to do that.
Nice.
I went to the British Museum in London and found the original manuscript for the music for Royal Fireworks, but I could never find, there was never an original for the water music. But as Handel wrote, he did the same instrumentation for the water music. But he must have done at least 30 or 40 different arrangements of the water music. He himself did for all kinds of different instrumentation. But we do Handel's water music and the fireworks. But tonight we do the overture for the Handel's water fireworks. Music for the Royal Fireworks. And then we do this Zouk piece, Scherzo, which is a delightful piece. He wrote that when he was 17. And then we do a Petrov piece called the Russian Capriccio. And we do a Hop Concerto by Hank Baden, who was a very wonderful man from Holland. And then we do an Adagio by Rodrigo. That is sort of a nice story also, because I wanted always Rodrigo to write a piece for me. He was a famous Spanish composer. And so Generalissimo Franco was in charge of Spain at the time. So they weren't flying in, you couldn't fly in, but you could go in by bus. And when I was going in by bus, I saw Circe out in the fields with guys with machine guns standing over them. And I saw people coming out of these caves. That's how it was terrible. When I got to Madrid, there must have been 100 children there. Many of them blind from venereal diseases. Some without hands, half a hand or whatever, begging. Anyway, I took a cab to Rodrigo's house and went up in a 3-story rickety one-person elevator. And his wife opened the door, and for the first time I realized he was blind. And so all the scores that he have ever been written are the hands of his wife. And the score that I have in there for this adagio, which you'll hear tonight, is also the hand of his wife. And then we do this piece called Three Fragments by Water. It's a wonderful piece with Rodrigo drums, etc.
Well, we're going to pack up here and then go down to the art gallery, but I'd like to thank Robert for letting us come here to the boat. Do we call it a boat?
You call it a vessel, a boat?
Vessel, boat.
Let me. I have not tried. You know, you asked me about that. You had not known too much about it. The people that I care about, not that I don't care about you, but the people I care about are my people in the towns. Mm-hmm. In September, I'm not going to do this in September, but in the past, I look at a map. I wanted to get the boat. We went to Yale University for the International Festival of the Arts a year or so ago, and I need to get the boat back to Louisiana. So the reason I'm having this tour is to get the boat back, but also having the tour of the Great Lakes, which we've done 3 or 4 times. So my job in September is to go to these towns and start to organize them and sell them, raise money, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So I have a staff of 2 people, basically, my wife and myself. That's our staff. Mm-hmm. But I probably have 500 people out there who are working in each town, 50 people in each town, or 30 people in each town, who are working for hospitality. They house all my musicians, raising monies, docking spaces, all that kind of thing. So all of these towns are organized. Mm. So I don't care about the outside world knowing about me. I care about those towns because that's how I earn my living.
Sure.
Whatever living there is to make out of this thing. Mm-hmm. But that's what makes us alive. But I assure you there are people all over the world that know about the additions and know about the music that we do. Mm-hmm. I get letters from all over the place talking about the music that they're renting or whatever.
Sure. So thank you, Robert, very much.
My
pleasure. It's a pleasure to meet you in person.
Well, thank you.
And we'll look forward to the concert tonight. Yeah. We'll go downstairs and see the art gallery.
Only my 53rd year.
That's it?
53? 53. That's it.
53 years.
Not so bad.
So if you want to find out more, check out the links that are on the website. And have a great concert tonight.